Congratulations on a landmark show. It has been a feast to an art lover to come here and see a body of work which has shaped the decades of your artistic journey. Can you share some of the incidents from, you know, you have spent so much of time in art field?
Coming from an agriculture family, and I didn't know that there was a career as an artist. By chance, I started doing actually some painting and eventually ended up in Madras College of Fine Arts and took a sculpture as my subject. But all through my career, I think I have followed my route or inspiration from my route. Mm-hmm. And this is the altar of a ritual dance of Kerala, Theyam. It is in my village. And that is actually the source of inspiration for making this sculpture. And this altar, in fact, my exhibition was inaugurated by lighting the altar lamp by my students. I avoided all conventional
lighting of the lamp
inauguration
procedures. Who was your teacher in Madras School of Art?
K.C. Panikkar was a source of inspiration for me to leave a regular salaried job in the railways. Okay. And then I joined the college and he asked me not to waste my time.
How long you were in railways?
6.5 years.
Okay.
As a draftsman.
Okay.
And that has influenced my technical background really helped me.
Yeah.
And these are actually the jewelry enamel painting,
yeah,
which I learned from my father-in-law. And he is considered to be the greatest enamel artist of Italy. And so here, I used not only jewelry enamel, but also silver on copper base. And it's baked in an oven and it is in a controlled condition. Half a minute of baking time or plus or minus 7 degrees or 5 degrees of centigrade can actually change the tonality of the color.
No, overall locating your work, you have this, you have done research and you come from a background where you are so close to the ritual practices. How has it affected or molded your work over the period? It's almost like a constant, been involved in, taking the experience and then transforming that into your own work.
You are correct.
Yeah.
I have used the resource material of my root and my village traditions of Theyam and later as a part of Buddha studies and many other ritual performances. But mainly these are the inspiration, but eventually I used my modern technology and the AutoCAD drawings for generating the engineering, AutoCAD drawings and TIG welding. So some sketches, some sculptures, I have used hundreds of sketches.
Mm-hmm.
Then it has led to drawings. from drawing to AutoCAD designs, then to laser cutting factory. From there, the cut pieces were transferred to a welding fabrication unit, and I used TIG welding. Mm. So in a way, these are actually high-tech sculptures, from a sketch to TIG welding and laser welding also. So that is actually the how the work.
Even when you connect with the ritual practices and visuals, you bring a certain language of minimalism. And bring in a certain language of, a certain geometry is there, there are fractals involved. Can you say something about that?
Yeah, you see, there is no conscious effort to make a minimalism or anything.
Okay.
But it has all happened or reached to that level by spontaneity. Mm-hmm. Not because of, I allow my instinct to follow the tradition, the root of work, then it really reached to that level of all my complete work. But my reading habit and awareness of what is happening in the world of art has helped me to do these modern sculptures.
Even when we look at your body of sculpture, the earlier sculptures were really handmade, and then as it comes in the last decade or so or slightly more, your involved technology are used, various kinds of cuttings and this one. The whole language also has changed, I think, in a certain way.
But really modern technology and modern, especially computer generated drawing has helped me to make perfect forms.
Mm-hmm.
That really is what you can see in my conch or there's Balambiri Shankar that there and Kannadi Bimbam here, and there are so many other sculptures which has really developed to that form because of the modern technology.
What is that fascination with metal? I wonder sometimes whether your experience in railways has somehow...
It has helped me, definitely, I would say, because of the... I was absolutely sure about the plan elevation, side elevation, sectional, form of any...
Any
object,
given form.
Any given form. I can actually, depict in my sketches, drawings, and develop
technical
drawings. Change of idiom or how I started metal is something by chance.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I was admitted as a second year, directly in the second year of a 5-year course in College of Fine Arts, and we had to work on different medium as a part of a curriculum, that is drawing, painting, sculpture, and metal work, and art history, etc. And when I started doing the sculpture, I felt very comfortable and switched over from a painting course to sculpture subject.
Just coming back to your, bringing the ritual, this one, a work like this is a chakra.
Yes.
Where you have taken the mandalas and there are many such works where you take ritualistic concepts and then you build a sculpture out of it.
See, this sculpture, Sri Chakra, is actually three-dimensional. And using a computer generated drawing and accurately following the traditional rules or traditional conventions, and was able to reach to the almost perfect shape. Mm. And this was possible because of a computer generated drawing.
Okay.
And also laser cutting.
Yeah, which is very precise.
Precise. Laser cutting, you get actually the gap of a cut edge is less than the thickness of a hair.
Mm-hmm.
So that makes it really well.
So you are able to bring two worlds together, a world of tradition where ideas and concepts are so rich, and then you have molded or mixed them with this idea of very precise technology.
Absolutely, you are correct. That I was able to combine the traditional forms and modern technology and depict in the most accurate and perfect shape. Yes. This because of my two reasons, one instinct, one thinking process. The second is the available technology at my disposal.
Can we see inside some of those
and
ritual photographs, which you have been documenting for a long time? And then you also mentioned in one place that IGNC has acquired some of these photographs.
IGNC has acquired 1,600 photographs, and it is in a safe hand. I'm very happy about
that. So you're looking at them not only as just a visual, but you've documented the whole process of the ritual and then the background, mythology and stories behind that.
In fact, one of a landmark event happened in my artistic career is actually the invitation from Kamaladevi Chattopadhyaya for giving a presentation of a lecture
in the India,
International Center. And that was really the starting point of serious academic research, which led to Nehru Fellowship.
I think if I look at the overall Indian context, there are very few artists who do research, academic research, as well as bring some of those qualities into their work.
Well, I don't want to say if any other artists have done, but
very few, I would
very
say.
Few maybe. Yeah. But still, I would say K.G. Subramaniam is my idol.
Yeah.
Because he is also excellent writer, excellent teacher.
And Jyoti Bhatt. And,
Jyoti Bhatt and Ghulam Sheikh. These are Baroda group. And they have done academic work as well as creative work. There are some of the photographs which you will never see again because the performance is gone forever. For example, this one.
Okay.
You know, this will you will never see the performance. There are many performances which were existing during my grandmother's time and even my childhood are no longer performed because of the modern, belief and.
For example, what would be a ritual like this?
This ritual is connected with the safety of the pregnancy of women, and now there are modern medical facilities and other things. So this is not really necessary for the belief, and it's also connected with the sorcery and occultism, and this is a warding of evil spirit from the woman who was possessed by the evil spirit, and this is the beginning of that ritual performance, and eventually within about 15-20 minutes she goes into a trance-like state and the priest exorcises the spirit from her,
Primal feminism, Bhagavati, this one is the main theme which recurs in your work at many different levels.
Yeah. Because in Kerala, there, in northern Kerala especially, there are hundreds of shrines for Bhagavati and the Bhadrakali concept in Theyam.
This
is related to that. And if you come from this Theyam series, you reach to the Theyam here. And important thing is that historically, this evolution of art form started from a very primitive society. So the first form of Theyam are connected with hunting.
Okay.
So five animals
like
are
animistic kind of
five wild animals spirit of five animals are actually worshipped. That's an elephant, bison, wild boar, tiger and snakes.
In one of them I think there is a animal being held within the sun,
breast. See the snake around the
snake form.
Snake form, which is a subject of my research. I have published a research paper on snake motif in myths and myths, legends, and folklore. So this is one of the slides.
But it is not Nagadevata.
It is not Dangadaga. It is actually Rakthachakra. It is a local heroine who met with a wild death, violent death. And then spirit is actually deified and worshipped by the villagers.
What interests me is that though these are human forms or forms of goddesses and gods, when it comes to your work, it gets distilled. You don't see human forms, So that distillation process, I think, is very interesting.
It's actually an evaluation or, a thinking process. And I'm conscious about it. I mean, it's not by accident. Because, one thing if you notice in my work, I have never created a work for getting an applause. I was serious, and my works are not meant for laymen. And I follow the quotation of what Picasso said, that a really serious work is not meant for ignorant innocents. So I need some general public to get elevated to the standard of my work than actually going back to
down to
the level. Once I was invited by the Indira Gandhi National Center of Art to write a paper on a mask. And I did actually that.
And some of this mask,
because whenever I do any research paper, I would like to get surrounded by that subject. Mm-hmm. So in order to familiarize with the mask forms in all over the world, I collected photographs, drawings, whatever resource materials are available. Mm-hmm. Then I made these drawings. And these are actually the sculptures I made as a commissioned work.
Okay.
And they are very large, you can't bring it for an indoor exhibition. Yeah. So I kept it here. Here, some of my drawings, very early drawings.
From your student days?
A student, much before. Before I joined the college, this was done in 1962, mm-hmm. and I joined the college in 67.
Okay.
So 5 years before I joined the college, I did this from life studies. So I had been practicing intensely, you know, without bothering about showing or having an exhibition. Having said that, I would also say from the year I joined the college, I started holding my exhibition almost every year. Even my first exhibition was held before I joined the college. Mm. But from first year of the college onwards, I was holding at least one solo exhibition every year. Incidentally, this is the sculpture for which I got a national award in 1981. Mm. I don't want to sell it, so I'm just keeping it as it is.
Those paintings are from your student?
This is 69. Yeah. I was a student. Yeah. And the 1, 2, 3, 4, these paintings are actually all student days. In Kerala, where I come from, there is a Kalaripayattu practice. And in Kalaripayattu gymnasium, there is an altar with a seven tails.
Before starting
before starting any practice, they go and pray to the goddess. Goddess is a sheep or kali. Mm. And this is an altar of a Kalari gymnasium, which is normally installed at the southwest corner. Mm. It's exactly the same form. And then
it is very interesting that those gears and
that mission parts I kept symbolically
Deepam.
And this is the drawing of that Valampuri Shankha, which
we'll see it outside later. Yeah. And in fractal design that you are so fond of, the form of conch is the perfect
and it has a lot of a technical advantage, or symbolically it is it gives the perfect om sound when blown in auspicious occasions when it is used. So there is a auspiciousness, and most important for me as an artist, it's the proportion of the width to height, which is the golden ratio in aesthetically perfect form.
So a drawing like this, before coming to this, you would have made some more drawing in hand.
Hundreds of sketches, hundreds of sketches. The process is normally hundreds of sketches. Then what is selected, I draw again in a graph sheet.
Okay.
And then I go to
precise.
And then I go to the AutoCAD drawing. Mm. And then it's a laser cutting. Then TIG welding. And these are three of my large monumental sculpture. And this I made it last year in 2016 for the banknote printing mill in Mysore. This is a building of
organization
of Reserve Bank. And this I did for the Indian Oil Corporation.
So this idea of spiral is another
I have used very often.
Reaching out or reaching up.
Absolutely.
Or reaching within.
Yes.
I think those are the
spirals. There are logarithmic spiral and Archimedean spiral. And I used logarithmic spiral more often. Okay. I never used Archimedean spiral. This one sculpture, again, is a Saptamatrigas. That is Vaishnavi, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Indrani, Chamundi, Varahi, and Kumari. Mm-hmm. So there is actually Brahmi, Vaishnavi, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Indrani, Chamundi, Varahi. In that kind of Bhairava and Ganesha. This you can see in the southern side of the temple of the west coast in almost everywhere.
But here it becomes a conceptual form.
A conceptual
rather than retaining the outward.
Absolutely.
representation.
Almost every Shaktaya temple you will see this. See, it happened by just a coincidence. When I was invited by the German cement factory to do a sculpture.
This was in 78.
I did some sculptures, and one was exhibited in Constructor 78. And
Handmade form.
When I made another sculpture of conch in cement, the senior research assistant or research officer came with the tape and measured and said it has a perfect golden ratio. I didn't actually calculate in advance or use a measurement. I made it, and he found out that my work has a golden ratio. From then onwards, I started studying on that and doing research on that. Then I found out it has actually a lot of ramification in many of my cultural background. So I used that symbol and made a stainless steel sculpture 20 years later. 78 to 2000, 22 years later, I made another sculpture commissioned by Texas Instrument. Then I asked their permission whether I could do one more version of it. They said yes. And that's how I made the second version. The first sculpture is in the Indian Institute of Science, because Texas Instrument gifted to it. See, this has a many symbolic meaning inherent in this Valampiri Shankha, because when you blow the conch on an auspicious occasion, which is normally done, it produces the perfect omkara. Om, which is a combination of three root sound, A, U, Am. And here I was fascinated by that symbol. And Texas Instrument asked me to do is a sculpture depicting DSP, digital signal processing. And so I used the conch as a symbol of digital signal processing, and which really resulted in an excellent.
Here is a form where the form, the space within and without merges,
yes,
and also the sense of sound that can be produced on the perfect form.
It gives the perfect omkara sound. It has a beautiful mathematical proportion, and it's very easy, very comfortable to look at, because the proportion is 1:1.618. That actually helped me to make this. Incidentally, this was published in 1982 Limca Book of Records as the first high tech sculpture in India. So. And this trajectory which you see, and I have done two work there, and this actually follow the golden ratio proportion.
Okay.
Even in this also, this weaver bird nest, actually there is a golden ratio with this. And incidentally, many of my work started actually having this proportion of golden ratio without a conscious effort on my side.
At an intuitive level.
Is intuition actually led to that.
Many of your works have been placed in a public place.
Yes.
And of course some have been lost also. But how do people react to those?
I was fortunate. Whenever I got a commissioned work, the sponsors were always happy, because there are almost always it was more than what they expected. So it was very gratifying for me. But I am facing extremely vital problem in Indian context of artists who are doing outdoor sculptures. There is no law in India to protect the work of art in public space.
One of your ongoing, this one is engaging with children.
Yes.
You have been doing it for years.
Yeah.
It is a way of nurturing the future generations.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a way of opening them a new world, which at some point enrich their lives. Can you tell us something about that?
No, I have been actually conducting art classes for children from 1971 without collecting any fees. But the main reason is actually to impart my knowledge to younger generation. So there are two purposes. If there are talented students, they will take a part seriously.
Yeah.
Even otherwise, it is sensitive audience to view the exhibition of my tribe, the artist community.
Yeah.
These are some of the sculptures I made very early in my
career. These are gas cut type.
This is a plasma cut.
Plasma.
This probably is the first sculpture ever I made, and I had a 5 months unofficial internship at the IIT Madras when I was a final year student of Madras College of Arts. At the college I was giving attendance, or supposed to be giving attendance mark, but I was working at the metallurgy department of Indian Institute of Science doing bronze casting and welding. That training of 5 months has helped me a lot in my metal sculptures. And this one, two, and there are two there. These four sculptures were actually made during that period.
I want to go back to this idea of, even though sculptures and art are kept in the public domain, the public are not ready for that. They are not trained to look at it, or sometimes they don't even have the time to engage. And what can be
Serious work of art is always noticed by people. When it is actually substandard work, they are indifferent to it. And absolutely really serious work is always noticed by people. You can't actually blame the society, because we have to expose them, the really serious work. Artistic career. There are several sculptures lost forever. And it's all because of apathy of the administration at the both on the police department as well as the civil society, civil administration. And for example, this sculpture was actually in the level road for 18 years. And it was one full midnight, they used a bulldozer and removed it. Unfortunately, I was not in India. So I came to know about it after 2 weeks later. And when I made a complaint to the police officer, DCP, and ACP came to my house and apologized, and nothing happened. They promised to me that I could, they would meet the expense for making a new sculpture, but that didn't happen. And that is a tragedy. Tragedy for our the art approach to art by the administration.
Balan, thank you so much for sharing your journey and your ideas and concerns with us. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you, Ravi. And it is thanks for your team and for this recording an event. Thank you.
Thank you.